Good morning, you two. How are you guys? Alright. Wow, this is a beautiful place. Yeah. How are you guys? Very nice. Nice to meet you, Tom.
Sharing my life with God.
Yay. Alright. Just kind of get a nice little shot of this. It's a very nice place.
afraid of this whole snake. It's a don't carry the pants.
Yeah. Great-grandchildren. That's a lot of folks, isn't it? What a legacy. What a legacy. Oh, my goodness. Well, my name is John Jicka. I'm the pastor at Smith Memorial Baptist Church in Williamsburg, Virginia. It was my pleasure to know Martin and Grace for a time. We all arrived at Smith Memorial Baptist Church together. They welcomed me into the family, and I welcomed them into that church family. Privileged to be Martin's pastor at a time when he especially needed a pastor, and so we enjoyed some very serious and wonderful talks together, prayers together, and I'm privileged to be asked to lead the service today, so thank you for being here today. I know that it means the world to the family, and I've heard a lot of good things about most of you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for our Christian brother, Sherry's dad, Grace's husband, God, grandfather, and great-grandfather, and just dear friend. For so many of us, he's going to be so badly missed. And God, we wish we could talk to him now. But Lord, we will trust you, that you know what's best in all cases. And we just look to you now for comfort for those that knew him and loved him most. We pray, God, that today as we gather, we'll bring honor to Martin, comfort to the family, and God, glory to your name. We pray, Lord, now as we spend time together, Lord, that We know you're here. We know that we're gathered in your name. You've promised to be here in those cases. We pray, Lord, that your presence is felt, that you might give special comfort and a healing touch, Lord, to the family. We pray, Lord, now that you'll guide our time. It's in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. Mark was born here in Newport News, 1941. The oldest of three brothers. I guess these were his stomping grounds. He went to Warwick, as we heard. Went to apprentice school and worked at the shipyard for that long, long time. He and Martha married young and started a family young. They didn't have much. They gave their children what they needed to succeed. That's what I've been informed. He gave them love and support. Ball games and recitals, he was there. Good man, good dad. He provided for his family in the ways that mattered. He had regrets, as we all do. He had his insecurities and he had his obstacles to overcome. But God gave him grace. See what I did there? God gave him grace. All kinds of grace. Martin pursued God. He made sure that he had a real relationship with God, not just religion. Because religion doesn't save or really do much good for anybody. Relationship with God through Jesus Christ is everything.
Amen.
He pursued God. John 3:36 says, "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. But whoever rejects the Son will not see life. God's wrath remains on them." Martin believed in Jesus Christ, so he has eternal life. He did not reject Jesus. He fully received him, and the Word of God promises us that whoever receives Jesus, to them who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children of God. That's Martin. Martin received and believed and pursued a relationship with Jesus Christ. There's no question where our brother is today. We can take great comfort in that. Amen.
Amen.
Together with the other Grace, this nurse consultant he met at work, and he really didn't like at first because he thought she was going to take his job. He received a partner in ministry, and they sang in choirs together. They did all kinds of ministries together. They supported churches together. And now he is receiving his reward, the treasures that he laid up in heaven.
Amen.
And those treasures, 1 Peter 1:4 says, are an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven. In July of 2019, Martin was diagnosed with cancer. That's when I really got to know him well. God gave him mercy to prepare from 2019 to from July 2019 until just 2 weeks ago. That's mercy from God. And then God said it was time. New Year's Day is an interesting time to go to heaven. Is it? New Year's Day. That's God's choosing. It's God's gift.
Powerful.
New Year's Day. We think about New Year's Day, we think about having accomplished whatever we accomplished in the last year and getting a new start. And we can say of Martin that he accomplished what he accomplished. He ran his race. He finished the course. He fought the good fight. He kept the faith. He accomplished what he accomplished. And so he could close the books on all of that. And on New Year's Day, he started a new thing. A very, very new thing. A fresh start. Can you imagine the fresh start? How fresh is it to shake all these things in this world? 2 Peter 1:11 says, "You'll receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." A rich welcome, that's a fresh start to the eternal kingdom.
Sickness no longer hindered him. Cancer no longer cursed him. Death no longer loomed over him. Sin no longer plagued him. What would it be like to finally be free of temptation and the flesh that keeps tripping us up? He no longer had anything to fear, no shame to feel, no struggle to overcome. His eternal life that God promised him began. New Year's Day. Wow! I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Seems like we ought to think about that song. I was going to sing this song about Martin's fresh start. We only can imagine.
Only imagine.
Psalm 23. This is the Message version. Forgive me if I stumble because I'm memorizing the old King James, yep. My grandfather, and I can't get that out of my head. So I'll do my best to read and not memorize. God, my shepherd, I don't need a thing. You have bedded me down in lush meadows. You find me quiet pools to drink from. True to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Even when the way goes through Death Valley, I am not afraid when you walk at my side. Your trusty shepherd's crook makes me feel secure. You serve me a 6-course dinner right in front of my enemies. You revive my drooping head, my cup brims with blessing. Your beauty and love chase after me every day of my life. I'm back home in the house of God for the rest of my life.
That was hard to do, not saying it in King James. I read it so often, times like this in the NIV, and people just look at me so disappointed. Everybody loves the 23rd Psalm. Everybody, most people who have been in church are familiar with it. Everybody seems to really want to claim it for themselves at a time when they need comfort. I don't know what you think about it as you've, you know, had it as your friend all these years, the 23rd Psalm. But to me, there's one word that is the key to the whole thing. The one word that is so important, the 23rd Psalm, is the third word. The Lord is my shepherd. My is key to the 23rd Psalm because he is the good shepherd. But you really have no right to the comfort that the 23rd Psalm brings if he's not your shepherd. And so if we will receive the shepherd, think about the shepherd. In Mark chapter 9, verse 36, it says that Jesus saw the crowds and he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without shepherd. He saw these crowds and he had compassion on them. That compassion that he felt for them, and I won't get too preacherly for you, it's not the time for deep exposition, but that harassed and helpless, that's what a sheep is like without a shepherd. A sheep without a shepherd is meat for a predator. A sheep without a shepherd is covered in parasites. A sheep without a shepherd can't tend to itself. A sheep without a shepherd turned upside down can't get himself right upright again. That's a sheep without a shepherd. And that's what the crowds were without the good shepherd. And Jesus saw the crowds and his heart went out to them. He had great compassion. And that word compassion, just because I can't help but be preacherly, he ached. He longed for them and he ached for them and he had great compassion for them because of this spiritual and literal situation they found themselves in because they didn't have a shepherd. We look around today and we see all the people that we encounter on a daily basis without a shepherd, and we realize they're meat. They're covered in things. They're turned upside down, and they can't get themselves upright. Jesus longs for each and every one of us that we might have him as our shepherd. And if we will have him as our shepherd, 23rd Psalm says that he'll lead us, he'll refresh us, he'll guide us, he'll walk with us through dark valleys, he'll comfort us, he'll vindicate us before our enemies. That's always good. He'll fill our cups to overflowing. He'll give us goodness and love all the days of our life and prepare us for a dwelling in his house forever.
Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not know the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. The wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. I don't know any of you. I met a couple of you earlier. I like you. And I like Paul Sherry and Grace. This guy from Las Vegas, I just met. I like him too. I don't know you. You don't know me. But the good shepherd knows all of them. Is he your shepherd? You may have encountered in your life hired hands that abandon the sheep and scatter the sheep. You may have had a bad experience, and I hope and pray you haven't, but most people have. But the good shepherd knows you, and he doesn't want you to be without him. Jesus is this good shepherd. He laid down his life for you, and he's been longing for you to lead you, refresh you, guide you, walk with you through dark valleys, comfort you, vindicate you, fill your cup to overflowing. He sure is good, isn't it? To give you goodness and love all the days of your life and prepare you for his dwelling place forever. Make sure you can say the Lord is my shepherd. We have a song Tom is going to sing for us.
The Lord is my
Grace and Sherry and what they thought Martin would want to say to those of us who have gathered here today from his heart to ours. I feel a little compelled to give you a chance to speak first. Does anybody here want to just share a memory about Martin before we conclude? Yes, ma'am, Sherry. Yes, please.
Hello, everyone. Grace asked me if I wanted to speak, and I declined because I didn't know if I'd be able to do it or not. But I want to thank all of you for being here. It warms my heart that my father touched you in a way that made you come out on this beautifully sunny and warm day. I just want to tell you that I was on a journey with my father for 60 years. And a journey is the right word, because not every journey has a beautiful day each and every day. There are some times you make a wrong turn. There are some days you walk into a beautiful rainbow on your journey. And our journey had our beautiful days and our cloudy days and sometimes our icy days. When we lost my brother 26 years ago, we went into a very dark period of time in our journey. And many of you were there that part of our journey, and I thank you for that. But I can say to you, as we enter 2019, whenever the time was, we enter despite my father's struggles with his illness and the other things that are wrong with him physiologically. We had a beautiful walk towards the end of his journey. And I hope you all have someone in your life that's a parent, someone that's been on your entire journey with you, like my dad has been with mine, that you can say at the end of the day, that person loved you every single day of your life. And whether you always make good decisions or not, or whatever it might be, he supported you and loved you. No matter what it was, what day it was, he loved you. And I just want to share with you that he touched me that way from day one, no matter what it was. And I just want to thank you and let you know that I am so proud that he was my father.
I'm so glad you said that.
Yeah.
Thank you. Anyone else? I knew I was supposed to. I asked Sherry and I asked Grace what they thought Martin would want to say to us today. As best they could gather from knowing him as long as they had. Two things. Take time to realize where you are and where you're going. Make each day count and be sure you know where you're going. That's number one. Number two, he would say, thank you for being a part of my life. I can hear him saying both of those things. Thank you. Let's close with a word of prayer. We're gathered in this place, Lord, where the bodily remains of people that you have known and loved since before creation, really, are laid to rest. It's a quiet place. But one day, the trumpet will sound. And the dead in Christ, those who said, the Lord is my shepherd, the dead in Christ, rise from this place in a dramatic way. It's going to be a great day. And we gather now with absolute faith and true hope in that day. We live in the hope of that day. The reality that that is going to take place, we can already claim it as its own because you said it. That's all we need to know. And so, Lord, as we commit our dear, dear, dear brother
heart into this place to, for his body to remain. Commit his soul to your hands. You said you were going to go prepare a place for him, but where you are, he could also be. So Lord, now we commit earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. But we look to heaven, where his soul is already with you in paradise. And we can't wait, Lord, to be reunited again at the reunion. Lord, help us to live faithfully in the days that remain until we see him again, until we see you face to face. We praise your name together. We love you. And we thank you for your presence with us this day and this hour. And it's in the holy name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen.
They just need you to help carry the casket to the grave site.
Okay.
If there's anybody that would like to sign the register book, it's still out.
We're going to head on over to the grave site. They've traveled back to Blue Ridge, and you're getting ready to come back. Yes, you certainly will.
Really good, yes. Do the colors stand for something?
No, it was just...
Just pretty. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He liked roses.
He did like USC.
He did. You're right, Paul.
God does not make mistakes.
No. You're right.
That's confirmation. That is so awesome. I'm going to come over here and just...
From Illinois.
Uh-huh.
They were so nice.
Oh, good.
They were
good.
Really nice.
Yes.
He used to work for our company.
Yes, he said that.
Yeah.
Yes, he did. Lee, he really...
He's a good guy.
Oh, have they? Oh, you'll... The trains are straight back.
Oh, where are you guys staying?
Tonight we're going to stay at the hotel across from the Richmond Airport.
Oh, honey, look. Oh, okay. Hey, you look like a...
Joanne!
Hey,
you're on film, baby.
You look like Inspector Clouseau.
Yeah. This is in honor of Martin. I'm wearing his jacket tonight.